They are movers and shakers of society. They are people who make things happen. They are headliners and legends. But behind all of that, there is a human being. Join me this and every Saturday on Headliners and Legends, where I spend time speaking to some of the powerful people of our society, where we look at these people to see the movers and shakers of industries and people who make a difference, to show you what it takes for pedigree you need to get a shot at some of this Black Star power. Hello there, and welcome. Thanks for joining me on Headliners and Legends. If you're going to be watching this show, the spotlight will be on the people in our society who make things happen, not watch things happen. People we've come to call movers and shakers of society. They are headliners and they are legends. However, behind all the glamour, behind all the fame, there is a human being there. So we're going to spend our time focusing on these people, looking at them to see, like I said, what pedigree you need to have a shot at some of this Black Star power. Today, the spotlight will be on a woman. This woman has gone through the ranks and served her nation. She has become Minister of Education, I should say, and ultimately the Attorney General and Minister of Justice, the first woman in this country to have done that. Who am I talking about? It's no person other than Betty Mould Idrisu. She was kind enough to grant us an interview. I had the chance to sit with her for over an hour, and I was amazed from what I saw and what I thought about her. Ladies and gentlemen, take a look at what happened when I met Betty Mould Idrisu.
The greatest thing in leadership is being able to withstand the shocks, because there are shocks. If you're a woman in Africa, maybe there are double shocks. Mm-hmm. But in every political career, there are curves, there are highs and lows. And you must be able to have the courage to withstand it.
Hello there and welcome. Thank you for joining me on Headliners and Legends. This show is meant to take you through the lives of some movers and shakers of our society, to let you know that they're human just like you and I. But we want to know what makes them tick, where they've been through, where they've been, to let them become who they are. In essence, we want to show you the pedigree it takes to become a mover and a shaker. After this show, we are hoping that you are inspired to know that you too can become a headliner and a legend. Today, the focus will be on one lady, yes, a powerful lady, who has risen through the ranks to the highest point of becoming the first female Attorney General and Minister of Justice of the Republic of Ghana. Now, she was kind enough to grant us an interview, and in this interview, it was amazing some of the things that I found out. You know that when you're in the news or when you're in a top position, sometimes media speculations, people speculations, things are said, and often the time perceptions are made about you. I found out something different. But I'll let you find out for yourself, ladies and gentlemen. Let's see what I found out when I sat down with what we call Auntie Betty. Let me just say thank you for agreeing to
this. Pleasure.
How are you?
I'm great, thanks.
You're looking mighty relaxed. And fresh.
Thank you.
Okay. Now, I'm curious. I mean, I'm glad to meet you today for reasons more than one. One of the big reasons is that you have been a woman Attorney General, mm-hmm. one of the few mm-hmm. on the continent of Africa. The only one I know, the only one I've talked to. Beyond all of that, though, I know there's a human being there. There's a person. You know, sometimes there are misconceptions when people think of people in positions. We have our own thoughts of who they are. So I want to spend time to get to know who you are. Auntie Betty, who is Auntie Betty? What would you say if I asked you who is Auntie Betty, what would you say?
I'm a mother.
Okay.
And I think that's the most important thing.
Right.
That I'm a mother of biologically three wonderful children. And I'm a stepmother as well. I have a great relationship with, you know, my children.
Okay.
And then I'm a mother of many. I love the youth. Uh-huh. So I'm a mother of many.
Wow.
And I'm a wife, a sister, you know, a friend, cousin, family member.
Auntie.
Yes. And I'm a woman lawyer. I think that that's what defines me, defined a lot of my years.
Woman lawyer.
Yeah.
Well, where did it all begin? Where were you born?
Jamestown, British Accra.
Really?
Yes.
Okay.
Jamestown, British Accra.
How was it like growing up in Jamestown?
I didn't really grow up in Jamestown. Our family house was in Jamestown.
Okay.
My late mother was Ashanti Royal from Kwabre. From Idritia, a village called Idritia in Kwabre district. And my father, my late father, is also from Jamestown, British Accra. And also his father came from Winneba. Mm. So we have, you know, I have that mix blend.
You're a cosmopolitan woman.
Exactly. Cross-cultural Ghanaian.
Right.
And I married somebody from the north.
Okay.
So, you know, I straddle most of Ghana.
Okay.
Yeah. So I grew up in Accra.
Okay.
In Takoradi.
Okay.
Because my late father was a timber man.
Okay.
He was, you know, quite influential, quite wealthy in those days.
Okay.
And he did timber, he represented West African farmers and so on. And was
so
with Kwame Nkrumah.
You are what people will call Dadaba, from what you're
yes,
saying.
Yes, very much so. Very much so. And I'm the only daughter, the eldest and the only daughter of my mother. So he worshipped me.
Okay.
And, you know, worshipped me. And it was his dream that I be a professional. You know, I have senior siblings, stepsisters.
Okay.
Half-sisters. Who... One was one of the first women professors in Ghana.
Wow.
Oh, yes, Professor Greenstreet is my...
I see. So you come from a very accomplished family.
Yes, I do, especially of women.
Normally, when you think about people that are dadaba, for lack of a better word, or people that have that come from homes that with money and opportunity, you will find out that and this is just my little thinking. The parents are gone. The children now struggle. So it goes from one generation and the other one goes down and maybe the other one that will come will struggle. What kept you going to become as successful as you are today?
Well, you are right. It's generational. I said my father was wealthy.
Right.
We didn't grow up with that much influence around us.
Okay.
We went to excellent schools and my mother struggled to keep us, there were four of us, there are four of us. My mother struggled to keep us through, you know, in those schools and in Ghana, abroad. But it was always that hunger, you know, I think instilled by both my parents that we should succeed.
Okay.
And success in Africa means being a professional, you know, being either a lawyer, a doctor, an engineer, you know.
That's right.
You know what it's like. So it was cut out for me what I wanted to do. There was not much say. And also, so part of this was in fulfillment of my own parents' aspiration, what our family, you know, came to expect of us girl children.
So you're thinking you were living to please your family?
I did law to please my family, yes.
Any regrets?
Oh, no. I can't regret that.
Okay.
Interesting thing is that when I was filling out the forms for Legon, I put anthropology, archaeology, as my... you know, as my choice to study. because that was my interest. I loved antiquity, you know, ancient Greece, ancient, you know. And when I got accepted to Legon, I looked at the admission form. It had law on it. I said, but how did this come about? No, no, my mother had gone and crossed out my choice and put law.
Your mother was bent on you becoming a lawyer.
There was nothing I could do.
You mentioned excellent schools you went to.
Yes.
Before Legon, which school did you go to?
I actually did my primary education. You know, when people say we were privileged or I'm now a tough woman, some of it goes back to one's background. I was in foster parents in the UK. I think this is little known. Mm. At that time, it was a mark of, you know, that, oh, she's living with a white family. Mm. But I was with a working class, myself and my brother and some cousins were with a working class white family.
This is before university?
Before university, in primary school. Came back, I went to Achimota, I went to Ghana International School. And I did a year at Accra, Accra. You know, before I went to the University of Ghana.
I'm a new student.
Ah, I'm sixth form there. And then, you know, that's what happened.
Okay. Wow. So you're a Motowner?
I was there for 2 years.
Okay.
But I'm very much associated with my year group. Okay. I was in Ghana International School.
Yes, okay.
Yes, as okay. well. And my mother struggled to keep us there, but I was there.
How so? You came from a privileged home.
No. We struggled to be there.
Oh, really?
Yes.
Now, you say you were with foster parents in the UK.
Yes.
How long were you there for?
I must have been there about 3 years. My father traveled quite frequently across West Africa for his business. And I think that they thought it would disturb my studies, so we should be stable in one place. Mm-hmm. And that's when we went there.
Okay.
You know, I went first, and then my brother, the one directly after me, followed.
Okay. So then you got to Legon, hoping to study archaeology.
Yes.
And then you find out you're going to be a lawyer.
Yes.
Did you fight it?
No, I've told you that we were taught to do what our parents told us. My little rebellion was to put what I actually wanted to do on the form.
Right.
But when you're confronted with a situation, no. At that time, also law, and I actually don't know whether it is currently so, but to do the LLB proper, we must have been about 100 odd students who were taking the first intake. In 73, and then to do the LLB proper, you had to pass some series of exams. Mm-hmm. And I was amongst the 40 chosen. I think there were 9 girls, less than 10 girls, mm-hmm. ladies, mm-hmm. in our LLB class.
Wow.
So it then became a privilege, you know, to be a real law student.
Okay.
Yeah.
So you started Legon. Your mom forced you now to be studying law. At any point in Legon, did you ever dream that you will become the Attorney General of the Republic?
No, there again, my parents told me that I was going to become the first female Chief Justice. So
not that far from it.
But ironically, my first employment was as an assistant state attorney at the Ministry of Justice.
Okay.
And I remained there almost all my life.
Mm-hmm.
So that was my job. Yeah, I never thought I would be attorney general.
Never? It never crossed your mind?
No, not really. I didn't aspire to that. Because my interest later on in life took me more towards academia.
Okay.
I taught at Legon, I lectured part-time for 10 years in intellectual property law. I instituted the course, and it's still there.
Just talking to you, my impression would be that you love to teach.
Love to teach. Lecturing, teaching has always been the most fulfilling part of my life.
Mm.
If you ask me of all the different facets of my career as a consultant, as an intellectual academic, as a lawyer, as a state attorney, as a gender activist, which have I loved most? Always, I will tell you, is the lecturing. Mm. I love to teach.
That's beautiful. My mom's a teacher too.
Okay.
So when I hear things about teaching, it fascinates me. And I actually have uncles and aunties that are teachers. Yeah. So I think teachers are great people.
Thank you.
Tell me about Legon. So you are a female doing law. And I would think that in those days...
It was fantastic. That's all I can tell you. It was absolutely fantastic. Not because of the life so much. The life was great. Mm-hmm. But it was the times we lived in. I think I should write about
which
this.
Times are those? That's
we
what we want to know.
We lived in the times and we were taught mm-hmm. by Chachu Chikata, Professor Mills. Yes, Chachu was there. Mm-hmm. And he taught us, even though we were virtually the same age. Mm-hmm. You know, he mm-hmm. was a child prodigy.
I hear.
So, yes. And Professor Akela Akwasoya.
Okay.
Dr. Kwesi Buchi.
Wow.
Professor Fiaju. Mm-hmm. And Justice Dateba. This was the world. Professor Ekuya Kwenya, mm-hmm. who is now Vice President of the ICJ. So this is the world of academia mm-hmm. that we were in. It was glorious, glorious times. And I think it was some of those experiences that drew me back to Legon mm-hmm. to go and offer my services, which I did free of charge for 10 years. You know, I loved it. Okay. They brought about this absolutely phenomenal, inspirational environment of high academics, but tempered with the fact that they were just a few years age difference between mm-hmm. us. So, you know, we could party together with them. They understood, you know, the youth and, it was just phenomenal.
With your tone and inflection, it tells me how much you enjoyed it.
I did.
Would you say that also influenced what was to come? Or just has actually contributed to where you are today because of the people you met in Legon?
Yes, because in fact they all became leaders right. in Ghana. Almost all of them are leaders in leadership. It influenced me in that way. They also influenced my area of specialization.
Okay.
And they also influenced me to always respect those in academia mm-hmm. so that the future generation, the generations after me, who I taught and who I didn't even come to meet, are now leaders. People like Atuguba, mm-hmm. people like Yoni Kolendi, mm-hmm. you know, people like Joe Deborah, Mama Yarega, people I didn't, some of them I taught, mm-hmm. some of them I didn't teach. Mm-hmm. And then some of the ladies, mm-hmm. they are judges and top lawyers.
You very well today. Accomplished people.
Very, very well. And it was a privilege for me to know them, to nurture some of them, and to interact with them and to have their respect. Mm. It was wonderful.
So after Legon, did you become assistant district attorney?
After Legon, I did my master's almost okay. straight away after national service okay. at the London School of Economics
okay.
in intellectual
one of the best.
Law. Yes, mm. I was one of the best at that time. So at the London School of Economics and Political Science, I did an LLM, and as I said, I was influenced by both Professor Akela Akpasoya and Dr. Kwesi Buchi to mm-hmm. read intellectual property law mm-hmm. because there very few people had that speciality mm-hmm. in Ghana. Mm-hmm. I actually got a scholarship. Mm-hmm. So when I came back, the Ghans amongst, if you know the Ghans around that time, mm-hmm. you know, from colonial times, the Ghans are mainly in the civil service and in the banking area, you so know?
Was that those times where was Gamashi known as British Accra?
Oh, Gamashi, British Accra is Jamestown, Denche.
Jamestown proper.
Jamestown,
I see.
Where we come from, my fathers come from.
Right.
So, you know, that was known for that it had that kind of hallmark. In fact, when I did my national service mm-hmm. at Ghana Commercial Bank.
Okay. What did you do at the Ghana Commercial Bank?
I was in the hall with the ledgers entering and I had a law student. Time. Yeah, it was after law 76, 77, I sat there and I made lifelong friends. Okay. Met my husband there. I've made lifelong friends. So it's a year that I'll never forget. Mm-hmm. And when I hear people talking about their national service, I insisted all my children do their national service because I realized the impact it can have on your life. I learned gan. Mm-hmm. My gan, I perfected, well, if you call my gan perfect, I learned gan there. Everybody in that ledger room was a gan. So we had 30 people speaking gan. And I told them, this is what I want to do. And they taught me. They spoke only gan to me, you know, for the
They forced months. You to learn?
Oh, to perfect. Wanted to learn. I wanted to perfect.
Okay.
Because my mother was Ashanti, so.
Ah, I see. So you did your national service at Ghana Commercial Bank. And then what came next for you?
I went to LSE to do my master's and then came back. And now I had to do my bar.
Okay.
Which I did with some reluctance, but I did my bar and I did it in 1 year instead of 2 years.
Why reluctance?
I never wanted to practice law.
Why not?
I told you I was interested in academics, mm-hmm. and more being a professor. So I wanted to do my PhD. And my father said that he thought that I should come back home and, you know, settle down.
Have you always been well-spoken?
I think so. My late father prided himself on being very well-spoken and insisted that we be well-spoken.
So then they knew the way for you then, because you were saying that you never wanted to practice. Mm-hmm. But, I mean, just speaking to you and the way you're speaking, you speak well, you make clear points. So natural course of progression would be where you went. But would you say that?
Law teaches you that as well.
Oh, I see.
It's part of my background.
Okay.
But law teaches you to be an accomplished speaker and thinker and analyst. What I love about the law is the analysis. It's a tool for analysis, mm-hmm. you know, and that is my passion in the law.
Hmm. Okay. So you went to LSE and you came back to Ghana.
I came back to Ghana, did my bar.
Okay. In a year instead of two.
In a year, I was there with the fourth and fifth years. That's when I, you know, luckily for me, they didn't do anything special for me.
Okay.
The only special thing they did was, and they didn't do it for me, but they had the fourth and fifth year exams on alternate days. Mm-hmm. So that was the year 79 where we had our elections, and a lot of our lecturers were involved in politics.
Okay.
Darucha, Dr. Daniels.
Is that how you got into politics?
No.
Okay.
So they gave us an extension that year. We did our bar exams, I think, in October or so, instead of July.
Okay.
So with that 3 months extra, I was able to study. I took a room at Legon and studied extra day and night. You know.
And in 1 year.
Yes, I was able to do that. I had a couple of exemptions.
Okay.
And I was able to do the bar, and I was called to the bar. Tragically, my father died 2 or 3 weeks before I was called to the bar.
Sorry to hear that.
But he was alive enough to know that I had passed and I was a lawyer.
All his hard work
exactly.
has not gone to waste.
Exactly.
Wow. Yes. Okay, so now you're a lawyer.
I'm a lawyer.
And then what came next?
Assistant State Attorney.
Okay. How was that experience?
Fantastic. I was at the Registrar General's for 10 years at least. In charge, doing a lot of my area of the law, intellectual property law. And the industrial side of intellectual property law is patents, trademarks, trade names, textile designs, mm-hmm. which is something very unique to mm-hmm. us in Ghana, mm-hmm. and so on. And that's the registry. That's where the registry was. So that's what I was principally doing.
Okay.
And I used that time to become even more steeped in both the theoretical and the practical aspects of intellectual property law.
Okay.
So it was a marvelous experience. I went on various programs. I became a resource person. I became a consultant. I became a speaker. I went all over the world in respect of intellectual property law until, was it 1991? Mm-hmm. Then they put me to the other side of intellectual property law, and I was appointed as the copyright administrator of Ghana. Mm-hmm. It must have been 92, 93.
It's starting to sound to me that you began realizing the potential you have when you were there. That you started to think, maybe this something can come out of this.
Or would rather, right? People started to think like
noticing you,
yeah,
and pushing you the right direction.
Because of my big mouth.
But you know, some people have big mouths and not, they don't say good things. And so if you were being noticed, then I'm sure it was for the right reasons.
Yeah, I hope so.
So you stayed there for how many years?
Registrar Generals, it must have been till 1990. So that was 10 years.
Okay.
And then from 1990, 91, I think, to 97, mm-hmm. I was copyright administrator for Ghana.
Okay.
And I also did quite a bit in Africa.
Okay.
You know, because it was
so you started having international affiliations
now. Oh, a lot of work. Mm-hmm. A lot. I was all over the world. It was global. It was phenomenal at that time. From then, I rose through the ranks. For me, it was at the dizzyingly, from assistant state in 1980. I think by 1996 or so, 95, I was chief state attorney.
Wow.
Yeah, you know. And then I acted as head of the international, they brought me back to the Ministry of Justice. So I was at the International Law Division until 2003. Mm-hmm. During that time, I did a lot of gender work as well. But from 2000 and up to 2003, and then I left the Ministry of Justice because I got appointments as the director of the legal division at the Commonwealth Secretariat in London. So I was a legal advisor for the 54 member countries of the Commonwealth.
Wow.
Yes.
That was big.
That was great. It was a very fulfilling experience. It wasn't quite what I expected, but it was an incredible experience to be able to do public service at an international level and at a very high diplomatic level, because I was a diplomat there. And it wasn't that I was nominated by Ghana. No, I got in, the Secretary General appointed me after interview upon interview, and I got in on my own merits.
You're telling me all of this, and I cannot help but think, the year you were in school, where you've been up until this point as we're speaking, being an African, knowing our traditions, knowing, and I'm not saying I condone to it, but knowing how women in society from those days, even till now, what kept you going? I'm thinking you must have been very tough to be going through the ranks like that, unencumbered. What keeps you going?
I had a lot of family support. I told you I come from a very accomplished family.
Right.
So, and I was always the leader because I'm the eldest. Mm-hmm. My late mother was the eldest of nine.
Okay.
I'm the eldest of four.
Okay.
And I've always been a leader. My mother's people are largely semi-literates, or literates. And so I learned that I have another side of the family and I need to step up for them, because my mother was there for them and she pushed me for the education, thinking that education is what gives you power and success to help others. So the early 80s, I was part of the women lawyers movement to empower women through legal literacy. We set up the first Ghanaian legal aid center, even before the national legal aid center.
Wow. I hope you're enjoying watching Auntie Betty as I did interviewing her. Now stay tuned, don't go anywhere. When we come back, we'll have more of Auntie Betty Mode Idrisu after these words from our sponsors.
The search is on for the top performers, the masters of their craft, who inspire the very epitome of accomplishment. Ghana, get ready for the People's Choice Award. Who was your favorite celebrity between 2013 and 2014? We're talking movies, music, radio, television, comedy, sports, and more. It's your choice. Text the name of your favorite celebrity to the short code 1446 on MTN, Vodafone, and Airtel Networks. The time has come for the people to speak out and make their voices heard. The People's Choice Awards. For the people, by the people. Sponsored by GN Bank.
Watch, answer and win for yourself something great this Yuletide on BTA. All you need is to visit our website at www.businesstvafrica.com and click on our Facebook account below the webpage and answer a simple question. This bonanza is on from 1st to the 31st of December 2014.
Hello, I'm Esme.
And I am Ebo. As the nation strives to build on its democracy credential, it's become imperative that the people begin to discuss issues of national development in a dispassionate and innovative way.
BTA's Back to Basics discusses issues collectively and in an unbiased manner as a platform for discussing national issues.
Join us on Back to Basics, where we keep it short and simple.
Let's help reshape Ghana, going back to basics.
They are movers and shakers of society. They are people who make things happen. They are headliners and legends. But behind all of that, there is a human being. Join me this and every Saturday on Headliners and Legends, where I spend time speaking to some of the powerful people of our society, where we look at these people to see the movers and shakers of industries and people who make a difference, to show you what it takes for pedigree you need to get a shot at some of this black star power. Thank you. Welcome back. We're going to go back and talk more to Auntie Betty to see more of her road to success or the highest office of Attorney General and Minister of Justice. Watch this. Would you say that you are naturally a type A personality?
I don't know what a type A personality is.
Take charge, make sure things happen.
Ups and downs.
Well, you know, from what I've read, most of the United States presidents have been type A personality. Mm-hmm. People of power are mostly type A. Because, you know, when you're trying to succeed, you're trying to fight or forge forward, there are times that you meet people that will want to put things in your way. They try to block you. And you would have to be tough to be sailing through.
If you're in politics, life is all about the curves in life. The greatest thing in leadership is being able to withstand the shocks. Because there are shocks. If you're a woman in Africa, maybe there are double shocks. Mm-hmm. But in every political career, there are curves, there are highs and lows, and you must be able to have the courage to withstand it. In Africa, in Ghana, let me talk about Africa because I'm very well versed in several of the African countries, the traditions of leadership, and I'm close with some of the strong women leaders we've had.
Right.
In Africa, you need to have support. Your support base, ideally, should be that of your unit's family. Mm-hmm. So your children, your husband, must be supportive. Mm-hmm. Your family, the extended family structure in Africa, is an integral facet of our personality. And I've told you that I come from a family both of high achievers from my Jamestown side, and then of semi-literates from my mother's side. And both of them have taught me about the courage of leadership and about the fact, I think the Ashanti side has even taught me more, the fact that we are a matrilineal society makes the women leaders. Yeah. Right? The women we make and break, we decide.
Which is going against the grain of the traditions of Africa.
You know, but it's not easy. You need that support.
You know, it sounds to me that your core was solid before you got into politics. I don't think politics is what made you tough. I think you were tough. That's why you're surviving in politics. Would I be wrong to say that?
I don't know what tough means, you know, because...
For me, I know it's relative, but for me, if I say tough, I'm talking about the mental sense. Some people think tough, well, it's fighting or screaming at people. I beg to differ. I think you have to be tough here. And that means being strategic, picking your battles, knowing when to move, knowing when to stop, knowing how to jump obstacles. That's what I see tough as.
To a certain extent, the last few battles I've fought, I've had excellent strategic advice. I've also drawn from inner strength, and it's because I'm secure in my family niche, and I'm secure also in the knowledge that some of the actions that maybe might have been questioned, I did from a purist, you know, from a purist philosophy and from an internationalist background, I would say, thinking that you're doing the best thing for your country, not realizing that these might be misinterpreted. Mm. But politics in Africa, if you're a woman, you need double courage. You need that inner strength,
even
which
when
I have.
You're a man, it's not an easy thing.
I'm courageous inside of me, but that courage has been truly tried and tested by this country.
I can only imagine.
You know, but I am extremely blessed that I find I have a deep faith now. And that deep faith didn't even only come about because of my upbringing as a Roman Catholic.
Okay.
Or so my Catholic. Mother, I'm a Catholic.
Okay.
And married to a Muslim, so it's okay. difficult to confess this publicly. Because people call me Hajia.
Ah.
Yes. But I found those I rediscovered my religion in the UK doing international work.
Really? How did that happen?
It was very challenging. You hear some of the things. I was there with Komla Dumo some of the time,
okay.
and I interacted with him
okay.
sometimes there. And I know the challenges he went through. Mm-hmm. Those are the challenges you face. And you have to have an inner call to be able to believe that God brought you here this point in time for this purpose. Therefore, do it. There's nothing that he cannot help you through.
Mm-hmm. So you live a purpose-driven life?
I do. Secure in the knowledge that I have to take the hand and follow. Wherever he takes me, I follow. So you have to have that security and that serenity.
Mm-hmm.
Once you get that, then your family support becomes monumental. My husband, his knowledge of politics and his activism in politics is one of the many facets that has enabled
me to
be
the strong man behind you.
Oh yes, because he was in politics for many.
No, you were married to him before you became Attorney General, right?
Oh yes.
Okay.
Oh yes.
When did that marriage happen?
This was in 1985, I think. Yes.
Okay. Wow. Okay. So after your appointment, then what happened?
As Attorney General?
No, after you were appointed by the Commonwealth.
Oh, yeah. I was there from 2003 till 2009.
Okay.
Till I became Attorney General.
Ah.
Yes, and that
was... How did it happen? Take us through. Did you know you were going to be picked to become Attorney General?
Not to become Attorney General. Not at all.
But you knew you were going to be somewhere.
Yes, Professor Mills had told me. Because throughout 2008, while I was in the Commonwealth, I had callings from different sectors in Ghana to come.
At this
back.
Point, you were secure. You knew I'm going somewhere.
Yes. During 2008, no. 2008, I wanted NDC to come back into power.
That's all you were focused on?
That is all I was focused on.
Okay.
And then there were calls on me. For me to take a leadership position within the party, within government, and so on. So I started, and luckily, I had worked with Professor Mills during when I was copyright administrator. He was VAT, so I was comfortable with him. My husband was deeply involved in politics. He had been a minister, Ghana's longest-serving defense minister.
Ah.
We had fought several elections together, done a lot of work
with
him.
So you had experience before
yes.
you started?
Oh, yes, before 2003. Mm. I was very experienced in grassroots activism and, working with the party. So it was in 2008 that I made 14 trips to Ghana.
From England?
From London. taking all my accumulated leave and everything. I could come to Ghana on pick the flight on Thursday night and go straight to Kumasi.
Wow.
it was great. It was a wonderful year.
Tell us about the day you got the call.
To come to the castle.
Moments leading to the call, the day you got the call.
Yeah.
And then when you got to the castle, how you were appointed.
Professor Mills had actually told me a couple of weeks, after we won, that Betty, I want you to be part of the government. I want you to take a ministerial position, but I'm not sure which one. I thought I knew which one. So
what were you thinking?
Foreign Affairs. I thought I was a natural for the Minister of Foreign Affairs.
Okay.
So that's what I really thought. Then I started hearing rumors about Attorney General. I said, no, that can't be. I never thought.
Why not?
There were many factors. Because I'm more of an academic than a practicing lawyer, that was my main worry, so to speak, and that I wouldn't be able to deal with the rigors of everyday court life and following cases and appearing for the government. That was my main worry. The second one was prosecutions. I'm not a criminal. That's not my background, criminal law. The third one was that they were all my mates who were the heads there. I loved them. They were all my sisters and people I had worked with all my working life in Ghana. I didn't know how I was going to be their boss, so to speak. So, in fact, it wasn't easy for me.
So you got the call in London to come to the castle?
And I got the call here.
Over here, okay.
And I went to the castle and I was with Professor Mills for some hours. I can assure you, it wasn't an easy decision to make. So,
hours?
It didn't take minutes. It took hours because
Asking whether you were willing or you had to go through a couple of positions before?
No. He spoke
directly to that.
Yes, I was privileged to have even been offered that position. I knew that, but I had several.
Did you push back when he offered?
Oh, yes. But you know, he was my professor and now my president. And whatever he wanted me to do to help him, I had to do. I knew that, but we had to have a thorough discussion about it, which we did.
Then it dawned on you.
Then it dawned on me that, hello, here you are, Betty, you are in trouble. But it wasn't easy.
First woman attorney general. Okay, so now you're attorney general. What would you say was your toughest day in office as attorney general of Ghana?
Almost every day. It is one of the most difficult positions in government.
What would you say so?
Because of the sheer amount of work that you had to do as an attorney general. They are in every region. There are insufficient numbers of attorneys. You are both a minister of justice and constitutional affairs and the leader of the bar and the attorney general, the principal legal advisor to government. It is phenomenally busy.
You know, but one would think, you know, this is Betty here. This is the brilliant woman.
Yeah.
So it should be a walk in the park.
No, it's not about brilliance being there. It's about having the best legal brains to support you and advise you. And because I had been there, I'd worked at the Ministry of Justice all my life. I knew the weaknesses there.
Okay.
Not only, I won't talk about the capacity, but a lot of systemic weaknesses that the ministry had, which we had to overcome. And first for me was the constitutional issue, you know, and then the capacity of the lawyers and their morale. And then meeting my president's expectations, the cabinet's expectations, international expectations, the expectations of my colleagues at the bar. Wow. It was like receiving several slaps in the face.
But I know there were also good times. I mean, I'm looking at a picture here in your office with you and Angela Merkel, one of the, top women in the world.
Yes.
If you were to pick, I'm thinking that the top 10 women in the world, she might be in the list. How does it feel to meet people like that?
I was truly privileged, Professor. She came through, she spent a day in Ghana, and Professor Mills and the Vice President at that time were unavailable. So he said, look, Betty, you're a woman. You know?
And I How is she like?
She's amazing. Oh my gosh. And so intelligent. You can't believe it. When they talk about brainy, brilliant, courageous, strong women, She's an example of it, not me. Ah. I was in awe of her. Really, I was awed by her. Mm-hmm. And I like Hillary Clinton, mm-hmm. I was privileged also to meet Hillary Clinton, okay. You know, and be with her when she came here. And people ask me, but why do you support Hillary Clinton instead of Obama when they were running for election? Mm-hmm. I said, she's a woman. Ah. And she's a tough woman. Ah. And she needs all the support other women can give her. Yeah. So, I mean, those were awesome times to be able to meet such people. Mm-hmm. And also, not only internationally, but nationally. Mm-hmm. You know, I was with some pretty decent women in the NDC, both in the party and at cabinet and fellow ministers. And, you know, it was a great time for NDC women, I think, for women in leadership. Mm-hmm. And it enabled me, my job as Attorney General, and when I was Director of Law, the legal advisor for the Commonwealth, enabled me to meet African women and women from across the globe who are absolutely phenomenal.
I would say, talking to you is talking to a strong woman. Talking to you is talking to a lady that advocates seriously for women. Whether in your past or your upbringing has brought you to that stage? Yes, we know you as the first female Attorney General in Ghana, but also I can tell that you really have a passion to promote women and women affairs and stuff.
It's because women were being cheated. I don't like to be cheated. And women were being cheated in Ghana and across Africa, mainly because of who we are, our gender. That kind of place, our place in society, our place in the home, our place in leadership is just because I'm a woman. That I will not accept, because my mother's people taught me differently. My father's family taught me that we can have, you know, we can and we are equal with the men. So I learned a lot when I was doing the women lawyers. I was with the women lawyers. I was secretary, president, co-founded my own African Women Lawyers Association. So, I mean, you know, there was always that realization that, look, the women are being cheated. They go to court. The laws are there, we wrote the laws, they go to court, and yet they lose the cases in court just because they don't know the law and they don't have the access to the means to enable them to get representation at the courts. So therefore they lose cases. A lot of men are also judges. Now it's changing. And it's all of this making women aware that you should be there. We can make a difference. We need to empower them. And it's been a phenomenal experience. I'm a woman's woman. You can tell that.
I can tell. Yes. I think I can tell. Let's talk about family for a minute. You've talked about your wonderful husband. You have children, three.
Yes, okay. Biological.
Talk about them a little bit.
My first son is a doctor. Okay. I'm very proud of him. As we speak, he sent me an email yesterday that he's an assistant professor and he was given a lecture in Addis Ababa.
He's following mommy's path.
Exactly. He's an assistant professor in emergency medicine. He also does, you know, he comes to Ghana and trains paramedics and so on. My second boy, Hassan, has a master's degree. He has both, and he's trying to be an entrepreneur, so I'm encouraging that aspect of his life. My third is my girl, my heartbeat, Shirika. She's a petroleum economist. Wow. She has. So they're very accomplished children. But as I said, I have other children.
Right.
And I have a very close relationship with them. You know, the last one just got her JD in from America in law, passed both her New York State and New Jersey bars. We have grown-up grandchildren also.
Wow.
Who have, you know, I'm very proud of. So
it's very hard to believe you're a grandma.
I am biologically. I have a little granddaughter. She's what, 3 now, Nanabna. Yes, I don't see enough of her because she's American-based. But
what makes a strong woman like you tick?
Tick. It's. I think that's a tough question because I don't see myself as ticking. I see myself as just going on and having to do it. I told you that I was born into leadership, you know, and when you've just got to get on with it because nobody else is going to do it with you. And one thing I must say that the family inculcated in me, I'm very close with my family.
So both family values.
Yeah, both extended and my immediate family, my brothers and their children, and you know, my older daughters and sons. We are all very close.
What gets you upset?
Injustice.
I almost thought I knew the answer.
The
to that
media.
One.
No, but it's seeing people cheated on a daily basis.
That's what I would have said.
Yes.
I would have said you don't like cheating. That's what I would have said.
And
what is one or two common misconceptions about Auntie Betty Moldedrisu?
The fact that I'm strong.
You don't think you're strong?
I don't like the word strong because in Ghana, no, that's not how I want to be looked at. Mm-hmm. I've also always wanted to be thought of as being a... I like to dress well. Mm-hmm. I like to take care of myself. Yes, I like to do all of that. Because, you know, it's your outer portrayal shows who you are. Mm-hmm. I was taught by one of my very much beloved teachers, Mrs. Akwa, that first impressions are always important. So your first impression of me is not only what I say and how I comport myself, but it's also the care that I take to put myself together, even when I have nothing.
Mm.
Even when I have nothing. The few dresses I have, I must make sure that's I portray
that
myself.
That really reminds me of my mother. My mother tells me that all the time.
But that is true.
Mm.
That is true. So it's not, I want to correct that misconception of strong women.
Mm-hmm.
It's being courageous, having the courage and determination to succeed.
But if I say strong, that's what I'm talking about.
If you talk about intellectually, I'm strong within myself because morally, I know I mean well to people. Along the way, you might upset people. But most of it comes from principles.
Right.
And I don't apologize easily. I don't admire people.
Is it because you think you're never wrong?
No, it's because it's because you must prove that you were right.
Mm.
And most of the time...
It's like a lawyer, huh?
Yeah. Most of the time, they're able to prove it.
Mm.
And I think if you ask me what my fault is in my strength, it's because maybe I expect too much from people. You know?
Also, explain that a little bit.
I expect people to be organized, to be, you know, morally upright, to be determined, to be fearless, and not everybody is like that.
Mm.
But I realized, that's what I like about lecturing. I realized long ago when I was, because I started lecturing from 1990.
Okay.
And I realized that, look, you must mentor people. So I'm also now, I believe, a great mentor. I have friends across the political divide, families across the political divide. I'm encouraged by the youth, and I love the youth. I'm able to, I think, communicate with young people, and I think both men and women, and I think that's a blessing.
This is a great segue to my next question, and asking you, do you give back to society?
Yeah, I do. All the time, I think, and it's not physical cash, it's by showing examples, mm-hmm. by leading. Mm-hmm. You have to lead mm-hmm. by example. Mm-hmm. And I try to do that, you know, in so many ways, not only in academia or in the law or in politics, but at a family level, at the extended family level, at the community level. Mm-hmm. I like to show that, look, I'm part of you. And why did I go into the Ministry of Justice in the first place? I was on Ghana government scholarship to do my master's. And I felt, even though I think it's obligatory, but I felt I had to serve my country. Mm-hmm. So that notion of service, I think, to one's people, at that time I was telling you, it's a very Ghana trait. Uh-huh. The older Ghanas amongst us will know that, you know, Ghana, where right. civil service, you know. So that's, you know, one of the traits I picked up.
One of the things that growing up I found very satisfying is giving back. So I'm not only a member of the Rotary Club, but I also have a foundation myself. One of the projects that I've actually embarked on is the School for the Deaf on the mountains.
Yes.
Whom I think need a lot of help. And I think in our society, people with disability are not being paid attention to.
I totally agree with you. When I was, you remember, I was Minister of Education as well, and I went to visit them.
Okay.
And my heart went out to them. Mm-hmm. I tried to get several things done for them, mm-hmm. just to facilitate their own living.
Right.
One of the sights, the days or the evenings in my life that I'll never forget, is the WA School for the Blind. Mm. I was in WA, and my husband comes from there. I was in WA when I was Minister of Education. Mm-hmm. And there was a fire in the dormitory at the School for the Blind. So I rushed there. The most piteous sight was seeing these hundreds of blind children standing out in the night, not knowing, not being able to even appreciate what fire, not seeing what was happening. And as minister, trying to assist them because their dormitory became burnt. And I know before I left the ministry, I tried to assist them to get an emergency structure through to do this and that. But you know, you come from a continent where physical disability, and I also have several foundations, where physical disability is viewed as traditional. Mm-hmm. You know, it's viewed as a stigma, mm-hmm. can be. Mm-hmm. Even widowhood mm-hmm. can be viewed as a stigma and a curse. Yes. So one needs to bring us out of that. And mostly, again, the other girls who suffer. But at the WA School for the Blind, it was both boys and girls. And it was truly a piteous sight. And I applaud you for what you are doing. I would call upon more people to wake up to the fact that a physical incapacity or disability is not necessarily a challenge that cannot be overcome in one's life. We have one of our ministers who is also from the North, Upper West, who is blind, but he's doing an effective job.
I'll say that next time, if you have some time, I will be knocking on your door. If we need it, either is a door that we need open or a direction we need pushed.
Sure.
Blind will come with you.
Sure, anytime.
Let me just say, you're an amazing woman. And it's been a privilege talking to you.
Thank you so much. I've enjoyed this. Thank you.
It's quite amazing how you have perceptions about people before you meet them, or you make up your mind about people from what you see in the news. Since speaking to her, there's a lot of things that I learned about her as a person and about life, period. In knowing that in life, there are tough moments and you need to be able to withstand the shocks of life. I also learned that she's a strong woman, a mother, and a family woman. And Betty, let me just say thank you for granting us the time to speak with you. Ladies and gentlemen, join me next weekend when we talk to another headliner and legend in the hope that their story will inspire you to greater heights. Take care of yourselves and each other. See you next weekend. They are movers and shakers of society. They are people who make things happen. They are headliners and legends. But behind all of that, there is a human being. Join me this and every Saturday on Headliners and Legends, where I spend time speaking to some of the powerful people of our society, where we look at these people to see the movers and shakers of industries and people who make a difference, to show you what it takes for pedigree you need to get a shot at some of this black star power.